Guitar Solo Countdown.
Hey everybody, welcome to episode 9 of Jimmy Wolf's Guitar Solo Countdown. In this episode, we're going to look at the greatest rock and roll band of all time, the Rolling Stones, and their lead guitar player, Mick Taylor. This episode of Jimmy Wolf is proudly sponsored by Jam School. Visit jamschool.com to learn more. The Rolling Stones formed in London in 1962, and by the mid-60s, the band became the official rivals of the world's leading band, the Beatles. The Stones made it their mission to not only be the rival band, but to be the villain band, the anti-Beatles. This trend would continue into the late 60s and early 70s, where this rebellious nature would make the Stones the most dangerous band in the media until punk rock took over a few years later. After guitarist and founding member Brian Jones drowned in his swimming pool in the late 1960s, the band would have a string of perfect albums that have yet to be rivaled. And 5 decades later, the Stones continued to be the most popular live concert act in the world. Keith Richards is one of the most recognizable guitar icons, but it was Mick Taylor who was the main guitar solo contributor of the band. Okay, so let's check out the top 5 solos of the Rolling Stones. Hope you enjoy.
Number 5. Number 4.
Number 2.
Okay, so can't you hear me knocking? I always get confused by can't. I always feel like it should be can you hear me knocking, but this is an awesome song. It has a very Santana-inspired sound to it, like a very jam, sort of Latin percussion sound to it. Apparently this wasn't planned. It was basically just a jam at the end of the song that just happened. I think the band didn't even know that they were being recorded, so it was a very spontaneous one-take jam. But Mick Taylor just really does a fantastic job here. He's doing a lot of blues playing, a lot of repetition, and that type of repetition creates a really cool hypnotic feel. So yeah, I'm a huge fan. Love this track. The whole song is awesome. I mean, I almost like the opening riff the best, but this is definitely my favorite Rolling Stones solo. Okay, let's check out the discography now. So the early discography can be a little intimidating. The reason is just because there's multiple versions. There's US and UK releases. There's singles that weren't necessarily on the records as well. So yeah, it can be a little bit intimidating. I'm gonna stick with the US releases for now. Okay, so the first album was called England's Newest Hitmakers. This came out in 1964. This is my favorite album of the early period. I feel it's the perfect balance of everything. It's got the blues, it's got the high energy rock songs, it's got really good pop hits on it. It had the singles Not Fade Away and Tell Me. And I love the mono recording too. I think it's absolutely fantastic. So great debut. The follow-up was 12 Times 5. This is a good album as well. I don't think I like it as much as the first album, but it's still got some great tunes on it. Good Times, Bad Times, the classic Time Is On My Side, It's All Over Now. Yeah, it's got Under the Boardwalk, huge song, Suzy Q. Yep, great record, great record. The next album, The Rolling Stones Now. This album, I don't quite like this one as much. It's got the attitude, that aggressive Rolling Stones bad boy attitude to it, which is fantastic, which is what I do love about it, but yeah, it's just, there's not a lot of singles on this. I just don't think it's as strong. The material is not quite as strong here. I love Heart of Stone though. That's fantastic. Mona's great. Okay, Out of Our Heads. This is another great one. It's just, it's got The Last Time, which is one of my favorite early Stone songs. I love that hypnotic riff on there. It's also got probably their biggest song that made them megastars, Satisfaction. It's got Play With Fire, which is unbelievable. So this is a really good record. There's a great consistency with really powerful and strong material in these first few records. It's really impressive. Okay, the next album, December's Children and Everybody's. I love the opener. She Said Yeah, fantastic song. It's got Get Off My Cloud, probably one of their biggest tracks. Yep, great song. I'm not really, like, again, this one's not really my favorite, but it is good. Okay, so when it gets time to Aftermath, the band is clearly writing their own material now, which is really good. So the band is sort of abandoning the covers. It's got this crazy epic, like 11-minute song called Going Home. It's got Out of Time, Under My Thumb, probably one of their biggest tracks, Lady Jane, and Mother's Little Helper. That's one of my favorite songs. And this is sort of showing that the Stones are really kind of, you know, really stepping out of the regular pop realm and talking about, you know, housewives that are addicted to drugs. I mean, it's pretty cool that they're going into these directions lyrically. Okay, so the next album, Between the Buttons, this is one of my least favorite records from this era. The band is experimenting with the psychedelic trends that are starting to creep in now. They're not really committing that hard to it here. It feels like they're a bit reluctant to do it, but you know, they are doing it. And yeah, I find that just that aggressive blues rock thing that the Stones are just so good at is starting to get left out a bit here. Let's Spend the Night Together is probably one of their biggest songs. Ruby Tuesday. But yeah, I'm just not really feeling this one as much. Now, the next one is quite a drastic change in style. So in the last one, the Stones were, you know, kind of dabbling a little bit in the psychedelic sounds that were happening around that time. But on this album, the band fully embraced it, almost to the point of it being a bit of a joke. But I have to say, I do love this record. It is a guilty pleasure for me. It's like eating candy. It's like a treat. It's just really fun. It's a fun album. But yeah, it was critically panned at the time. The band hates it. Okay, so after this odd transition album, we get into the absolute greatest rock and roll run, I think, of all time. This is the golden period of the Stones, and it starts with Beggar's Banquet that came out in 1968. This is where the Stones said, okay, we're not doing the psychedelic thing, screw it. We're going back to what we're really good at. And they came back to it even better than I think they even imagined they could. This is just unbelievable. We have Sympathy for the Devil. I mean, this has been covered a lot. It's been in almost every movie. Street Fighting Man, what a great tune. We're also seeing the band get really sleazy with the lyrics. You know, it's like the lyrics kind of match the album cover here. But that's rock and roll. The Stones are defining themselves as the leading bad boys of rock. And they're transitioning very well into what would be, you know, the dark artistic decade of the 70s. Okay, so the next album is, I think, a perfect record. This is their first absolute magnum opus, Let It Bleed. Yeah, I mean, I mean, just every song on here. I mean, Gimme Shelter, everyone's heard that. Everyone's heard You Can't Always Get What You Want. Yeah, just a fantastic record. The band was also going through some weird times with Brian Jones and his mysterious death. And there's also a lot of weird tabloid things, the Stones running up against the law with drugs and, you know. So I think this was only adding to their credibility. Now, I don't usually include live albums in these discography rankings, but the album Get Your Ya-Ya's Out is worth including just because it's such a classic. For me, I find the latter half is my favorite. By the time the band gets to Midnight Rambler, you know, Live With Me, Little Queenie, great version of Honky Tonk Woman on here. Yeah, I mean, just a really good record. Okay, so Brian Jones passes away, and the Stones get their greatest guitar player, Mick Taylor, and they come out with another perfect album, Sticky Fingers. This album is amazing. The album was really clever. It had an Andy Warhol painting of a man's crotch with jeans, and the cover actually had a zipper on it. And then the inner sleeve is, you pull out the inner sleeve and it's a guy in his underpants. It's pretty clever, I mean, silly. And there was a really good inner picture of a hand sticking out of a jar, or sticking out of a can, I guess, at Sticky Fingers, right? So this band's really clever. The album covers were great. The inner covers were great. Just very clever, very smart, really trendy for the time. And yeah, perfect album. I mean, every song is just killer. Brown Sugar, Sway, Wild Horses, Bitch is amazing. Sort of an underheard track, but so good. Dead Flowers is great. I also love the album tracks Sway and Moonlight Mile. These are probably two of my favorite Stones tracks. Yeah, so the Stones are basically unstoppable here. I mean, they're just, it's just perfect in every way. Okay, so I also want to include another record that I don't usually include. It's a compilation album called Hot Rocks. It's a double album. This was actually the first Stones album that I got as a kid, and I think it's probably the greatest compilation of all time, especially for the early catalog. I find that, you know, because the early catalog is so overwhelming, there's just so many albums. This is a really good starter. And even just a good compilation to have in general, because it really does have all their best songs. And it has a few unreleased songs like Paint It Black and Honky Tonk Woman that weren't included on regular records. So I would highly recommend this album. Okay, after this one, it is my favorite Stones album. And I mean, arguably one of the greatest rock and roll records of all time, Exile on Main Street. And, you know, at this point, you know, when you have a string of perfect albums, it's difficult to say which one is better. This is my favorite, right? So I can only say which ones I like better. I like it because it's a double album, so there's a lot of material here. I also like how some of the songs are a little jammy. There's a lot of non-hits on here, but they're still really fun to listen to. So you have to kind of take this album as a whole, right? It's not a collection of singles like some of their early albums. This is an artwork, an art album, where you have to listen to it as one complete piece. And yeah, there's some amazing songs on here. Love Tumbling Dice, that was a mini hit. Just so many amazing songs. Keith Richards has a song called Happy. It's one of the Stones' greatest tracks. You know, Let It Loose, All Down the Line, Shine a Light, Soul Survivor. I mean, it's just crazy. There's so many good songs. Great album cover. I think the name came from Exile. I think the band was trying to escape the ridiculously high taxes in Britain at that time. So they exiled themselves to France. So I guess that's probably where the title came from. Yeah, just a classic album. Okay, now the next album, I think critically it was seen as a bit of a letdown, just because, how do you follow up Exile on Main Street? But I absolutely love this album too. I would almost say it's almost perfect as well. If Exile on Main Street was the party cocaine album, this is definitely the heroin hangover album. It's very laid back. I love the album cover too. It's like, what is Mick Jagger? Like, it's obviously Mick. What is he doing? Kind of looks like a goat, but not really. Yeah, and there's also a really scary picture of goat's head soup, of a goat's head in a bowl of soup in the inside. So it's almost like the inside covers are just as great as the outside covers. But yeah, fantastic record. Okay, so that was the golden period. Now we're getting to the end of that period, which is fine. There's still going to be a lot of gems in the catalog. So the final album with Mick Taylor is It's Only Rock and Roll. This album it's good, but you can kind of feel like the magic is kind of missing here. This you know, feels like the Rolling Stones are trying to copy themselves, or they're doing what they think the audience would want them to do. So there's a little bit of, I'd say like the band probably is thinking a little too much here. But having said that, there's still some great songs here. One of my favorite songs on this album is Fingerprint File, which is a very deep album cut, but I love it. Obviously, It's Only Rock and Roll is awesome. That's a classic. Ain't Too Proud to Beg is an awesome cover. Okay, so now it gets a bit spotty. From this point on, the discography is very spotty. Black and Blue, I think, was a bit of a critical flop. I actually really enjoy it. This is another sort of guilty pleasure album. Kind of like their Satanic Majesty's Request. You know, like, you know it's not their greatest work, but there are just gems in it, and it's very enjoyable to listen to. Hand of Fate and Crazy Mama are one of their two greatest rock songs. Just killer. I think the problem here is the album's a little inconsistent. Like, you have two amazing rockers, which is great, but then you have sort of Cherry O' Baby and Hey Negrita. Like, they're kind of reggae-ish, which is a little... I'd rather the Stones stick to rock and roll. And I mean, Hot Stuff is kind of the same idea, where the Stones are starting to get a little disco-y or a little funky, kind of getting out of the rock thing a bit, which, you know, they pull it off, but... And some of the ballads are a little sappy, a little cheesy, but still a very enjoyable record. Billy Preston just kills on this. Just an amazing keyboardist. So, and yeah, the band just is on fire here. Ron Wood is now in the band. So yeah, very good album, but spotty. Okay, this is where I get a bit contrarian. So the Stones are trying to be relevant at this point. And of course, the late 70s is a very trying time for rock and roll, because you got disco and punk rock coming sort of in both sides as like a pincer attack on rock. And you know, the Stones were kind of fighting this battle on both fronts, and this album you can definitely tell that. So they have like the sort of more disco-y track, like Miss You and Beast of Burden are kind of more in that genre, but then they're getting a bit more punk rocky with When the Whip Comes Down and Shattered. You know, this album was well done. Like, it was a very smart record. It kept the Stones relevant. It's got a wicked album cover. Beast of Burden is one of their greatest songs. I don't really get much out of this album. I think the reason is I like the Stones doing more rock you know, more straightforward rock and roll stuff. And I love it when they have keyboards in their music. This album sounds very stripped down. It's like they kind of scrapped the keyboards on this one. Okay, so the next album, Emotional Rescue, sees the Stones fighting the same battles they were with Some Girls, where they're trying to stay relevant. They're fighting disco and punk rock at the same time and trying to keep their brand as the world's greatest rock and roll band. I mean, this is it's a tough battle, so I understand. You're probably not going to get a perfect album in this genre here, because it's just the environment is a little hostile. But, you know, this album, I think, suffers from bad advertisement. I think the album cover sucks. I think Emotional Rescue was a bad single. You know, it kind of shows the band being a really goofy, like a goofy disco band. I just don't quite see the Stones as being that. You know, there are some amazing tracks on this album, so, you know, it does definitely redeem itself. But yeah, I'd probably rather just make a compilation album of those songs. Okay, so we get to the next album. This is fantastic. I love this album. Tattoo You, for me, is a huge comeback. I think this is the greatest album since Goat's Head Soup. It just shows the band becoming a rock and roll band again. You know, it's like they said, screw it, we're going to do what we do best. Let's stop trying to fit in. Let's just be a rock and roll band. And, this is a near perfect record. I mean, this could actually easily be a 10. I think the fact that it was released in a weird time for the band probably makes it a little hard to give it a perfect 10. But, I mean, geez, like everything is, it's got Start Me Up. Everyone's heard that. Okay, so now the Stones are deep into the 80s now. So they release Undercover. And, you know, now punk rock and disco are done. But the Stones are, again, have to fight another battle to stay relevant in the 80s, which is a pretty tough battle. A lot of bands were struggling here. You know, there was a lot of new wave music coming out, a lot of really extreme pop music that used a lot of synths, right? So if you're a rock and roll band, how do you fit into this, right? And I think the Stones did a fairly good job here. This is another very functional record, like Some Girls. It fits in nicely to the 80s. I think they do a good job of staying relevant here. This album just has weak material on it, but it's a mix. It has really strong and weak material. I love how the album starts, like Undercover of the Night and She Was Hot are great. And then I love how it ends. Like, I love All the Way Down. I love It Must Be Hell. But I find the middle is just, there's a lot of filler in the middle. Yeah, I mean, I love the album cover. It's such a Rolling Stones cover. Okay, now the next album, Dirty Work. This is, you know, kind of universally thought as the Stones' worst record. I agree completely. This is a stinker. The Stones weren't really getting along here. And it's just very uninspired. You know, Mick and Keith were fighting. Charlie Watts was deep in addiction. This just isn't a very good album. The cover is terrible. So, yeah. Definitely skip this one unless you're a hardcore collector. It's not worth listening to. Okay, we get to Steel Wheels. This is definitely better than the last record. I would consider this album to be the Stones' most mature record or most grown up. It has a very kind of a hot adult contemporary, hot AC adult contemporary sound to it. A lot of these legacy bands were doing that. They were appealing to 40-year-olds, you know, guy, you know, people that just wanted to go to a concert. You know, we're still the Bad Boys of Rock, but we're grown up. That's kind of the vibe I'm getting off this album. And it's good. It's strong. It's very well produced, much better than the last record. But, you know, there's also this feeling that we're kind of getting further and further away from the golden period, and the Stones are, you know, more of a touring band, more of a legacy band. You know, but still a good attempt. Okay, now we get to the 90s. Voodoo Lounge was, I think, another really smart record. I love the front half of this album, but I really dislike the back half. I feel like the quality just drops on the second side or the latter half. But I think the first half really is smart. It has the Stones going back to being more of a rock and roll band, a little bit more sleazy. So they're, you know, this album is kind of like, I would say it's only rock and roll, where this is what the Stones think they should sound like or what the fans want them to sound like, and that was a smart move. Okay, so the next two records, I'm going to put these two together, Bridges to Babylon and A Bigger Bang. I find these albums to be well produced. The branding is good. I just find the material just kind of uninspired. You know, I don't really go to these albums. It's like, why would I listen to a bigger bang if I can listen to Exile on Main Street? You know, it's because we're sort of getting to the point where there's just so much material. And I mean, clearly it's not as good as the Golden Period, you know, and it's, you know, you could almost say with albums like Black and Blue and their Satanic Majesty's Request, it's the Stones doing something a bit different. But with these two albums, I find it's the Stones just doing what they think they should be doing, which is smart. It's good branding, but it's just not as inspired. So I very rarely go back to these albums, you know, but it's not really, I don't think it's the band's fault. I think they're doing everything right on paper. It's that sort of, it's that elusive art thing where sometimes it's just not there. And I find that, I just find like the inspiration for these albums is a little bit low here. It's also got Keith doing the introspective ballad at the end of the album. It's starting to get a little bit formulaic now. Okay, but Blue and Lonesome, this is different. This is the band doing covers, and I love this record. This is a very nice surprise. I think it sounds amazing. The recording quality is perfect. It sounds like it was done in the 60s. And this is a really important concept where I think the band is getting better with age on this album. Like, I feel like the blues is showing through. Like, Mick's voice is awesome. The band sounds killer. And yeah, I like this. This is like a band should get better with age. Okay, so that's the end of the Stones discography. That was a long one, but it was worth it. And yeah, so the next episode, we're going to be looking at the greatest Canadian prog rock band of all time, Rush. See you then.